done. This is amazing. I was clash heads again. This is like Chaz Mostyn.
It's motorsport, but not as you know it. Test yourself and your everyday road car. Safe, affordable, but most of all, fun. And all you need is your daily driver. Experience the thrill of a sprint day. Race against the clock at a hill climb. Or test your reflexes with an auto test. It takes just three simple steps to get started. Get on the start line. Search Motorsport Australia Daily Driver today.
Fishies in a row. They're here to make a point and to do Eddie proud. They fan out in the background as they come down to turn one for the first time. It all looks pretty good. Two by two. We'll stop the camera here. Oh, Eddie would be proud, mate. That was awesome run around turn one. But away! Contact with the fishies.
He's made it through. It doesn't look like Angus has made it, but Thomas Freeman's made it through, and Angus is going to suffer the crowd coming through there to be able to turn his car around.
I love riding. It's a real social thing. There's a great bond between riders.
Every weekend, I look forward to getting out there. It's a freedom like no other. Riding to work is a great way to start the day.
Shannon's insure all types of road bikes, not just classics. They offer features riders really want. It's why they're one of Australia's leading motorcycle insurance providers.
Whatever you ride.
Whatever you ride.
Whatever you ride.
Ride with Shannon.
Call 134646 for a quote.
And they are off. It was a good start from Dylan DeBono. I think Phil Vella got a great start there in the background as well. You can see already cars going 5-6 wide as they're trying to find any semblance of space. They come into T1. So far we've got 2-3 wide as they snake down. It's Michael Cunchard that's got around Dylan DeBono. A couple of cars going wide there. Was that a bit of contact in the back? Scott Pocock caught up in that, I think, there, buddy. But it's Michael Cunchard's got past, so Dylan...
Light is coming out and we're about to get going, and we have gone green light and a very slow start for the 86s, but they are moving out there on the grid. It would be very interesting to see exactly which driver can capitalize on this first lap. Just go through the grid. Look what Jamie Christensen had, a really awesome start to get ahead of Dylan DeBono, and Doug Gowage also jumped his teammate as well. So unfortunately Dylan stalled the car a little bit more than what he preferred, but
weekend in, weekend out, Motorsport Australia officials are making waves. From waving flags, waving cars through pit lane, or responding to a wave for help. Wave hello to new lifelong friends. Who knows, you might just make waves around the world. Ride the first wave. Search Motorsport Australia officials today.
Still great classes of car, and if you are able to, if you're coming up the ranks on iRacing through the licenses, it's a fantastic sort of laneway into prototype driving, going from that GT3 up through the prototype classes. As the safety car pulls in, we get ready to go green as we come up towards the line. Edwards, Hasler, who's going to get the jump down to turn one, or will any of the fishies, any of the piranhas in behind them, green, assault green, them green. Down towards
they're green and they're off.
First lap? Let's go here.
We've always had a few cars. They're all special. The T-Bird.
Oh, that's mine.
The Combi for when we want to get away. The XR8.
It's going to be a classic.
They're all insured with Shannon's.
We've also got Shannon's home and contents cover,
which helps protect our automotive collectibles, tools and memorabilia in the home and garage. If you're motoring enthusiasts like us, it's got to be
Shannon's.
Shannon's, insurance for motoring enthusiasts. Call 134646 for a quote.
This is amazing. I was clash heads again. This is like Chaz Mostyn and Cam Waters. Almost the same situation. Better contact going down the hill. Sam Noble wants to sniff on Dave Coleman now. Sam Noble.
Bottle right now because
tell you what, Bruce Tannock and Jamie Dyson just absolutely drove away from us. Hayden trying to go around the outside. This is where he could have just sent it up the inside, but he hasn't committed, which is fair enough. It's pretty scary out there, ladies and gentlemen. Now, let's see if we get a good line. Dodd's just absolutely peak competitive here. Really nice move. Blake Delaney had to move out of the way.
Good evening, sim racing fans. Welcome back to SRW TV. Tonight we jump back into the world of open wheelers for the fourth round of the new 2024 season of the Shannon's Formula 3 Nationals. With the sprint round at Mid-Ohio done and dusted and behind us, we head to Circuit de Nevers, Magny Cours. I'm sure that Hamish will get me for pronouncing that wrong, for a 60-minute race tonight, guys. It's Cowy Average Sim Racer here. I'm back together with Hamish Munro, who is once again behind the cameras and in front of them chatting with us. Well, buddy, I missed the action last week at Mid-Ohio, but talking to the drivers there before, that last chicane is going to be rather interesting, and I think a few of them are worried about how much the damage bill is going to be in the pits.
Yeah, I think after what happened out at Mid-Ohio, Cowie was, and even throughout the whole season, really, we've had a couple of big incidents happening. You know, I think Magny Cours definitely going to be a track that will challenge the drivers tonight, and I think you can almost compare it to Zolder with the kind of incidents we could see here. There have been a couple of controversial ones this season, but you know, with the F3s, you're going to get that. Obviously, the big news coming out towards the end of this iRacing season, we're not quite at the end of our season yet here for SRW TV, but we are actually getting a brand new F3 car. So it means that season two, we will move away from the old F3 cars and move into the new ones, which are actually going into their own class on iRacing as the Super Formula Lights. So it's going to be good to get those in, but it's going to be a good challenge for these drivers as well to make that switch. Interesting to see how long it is actually going to take them, though, Cowie, to get used to those new cars. I mean, it's not going to be too much of a changeover. They don't have to deal with DRS or with push to pass, obviously. But I think, you know, the current F3s, they offer up a good challenge. You know, Magny Cours offers up its own challenges as well. We've seen it a couple of times here in SRW TV. I think these cars are actually really going to shine here just for the type of circuit that it is, of course. It's well known, previously being the French Grand Prix circuit as well. And I know you've got a little stat for everyone at home regarding that. And it always produced really great racing in F1 and even other open wheeler series around here. So I think tonight we could be on for something that's absolutely magical from these pros, pro-ams and amateurs.
Well, is the new car the open wheeler that's going to be a part of the rain experiment when it drops too?
So I read through it on my podcast. I'm not going to shout out my podcast too much. Steve already gave me enough flack for that yesterday. So the cars that are actually getting it, so there are 11 cars that are getting Tempest from release. The cars that are getting it are all the GT3 cars, the LMP2, all the GTP cars as well, the GR86, the F4, and there was one other. F4. Yeah, there was one other as well.
I thought it might have been the new F3 car was the one that was going to get it, but maybe it's the F4.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, look, this track, I know it was, I think we drove here a season or two ago in the V8, and it was chaos at that final chicane. The pit entry is quite diabolical too. Now, in a V8 supercar, you can jump over the curbs. You can't do that in an F3. They don't like it. Not to mention just getting unsettled, but just the damage on the underfloor. And we know that the moment you get even the tiniest bit of damage on these cars, it can really affect, you know, your aero and just the control of the car. I mean, these guys, especially the pros, they're pushing as hard as they can. We've talked time and time again about this car being a car that you've got to, you know, really drive hard and trust to get that performance out of it. The faster you go, the more grip you get. Well, with a curb, you know, in the equation, that can really, spice it up. So it'll be interesting to see how brave some of the drivers are tonight.
Yeah, I think, and again, that's going to come down to the bravery. And we've spoken about many a time about consistency from these drivers. A couple of drivers have been a little bit inconsistent, you know, for these past couple of rounds. This is really going to be a track that will It will reward the consistency. Now, going off the back of, you know, our supercars, oh, not supercars, safety car predictions and stuff like that, I don't know if this is a circuit that's really actually going to lend it well to safety cars. I think this circuit is a little bit like Silverstone, where you could get a couple of safety cars or you could not. It's really, really hard to tell, and there are certain sections of track that can lend itself well to bringing out the safety car, but I don't know if we could see one tonight. Although the F3s, they are an unknown, and they are a little bit of
So is your answer zero then, is it?
No, I'm going to say we'll at least have one, being that it is an hour-long race. But I don't know. I'm not even completely confident in that answer, to be honest with you.
Well, I'm going to go with two because I know well and truly that you look at these cars the wrong way and they break. And someone's going to have a moment with those curbs, go flying off, end up in the fence or end up with a broken car that won't go anywhere. So I reckon two tonight. But as you said, later, she was a big week last week at Mid-Ohio. I've got some stats up there from good old Hutto giving us all of those, that great info. And he said, well, it's been five races over three rounds, five different race winners. So it's also Stephen Sinkovic's 100th start, if he's out there on track. Is Stephen out there?
He is out there, mate. He is out there. Yep. Is he actually out on track cutting a lap at this point in time? No, but he is in the session. But his brother is out there, Mr. Dean Sinkovic, rolling around in the red machine. But yeah, I think, you know, it's good to see the drivers consistently coming in here. I believe Steve is actually the first person to actually get to 100 race starts, if I'm correct. Which I'd be worried if he wasn't, being that he's the league admin. But yeah, 100 race starts for him in the F3. He hasn't been to every single round, but he has been to the most out of anybody.
Now, was it Dave Gallo who got his first round win last week, and that gives him a 23-point lead over his current teammate as well, Daniel Byrne with Carlin's Motorsports there, and Jay Dixon only 10 points back, so it's still pretty close for the pros. Looking at the pro-ams, Matty Gerrard, he managed a podium in the feature race. That's awesome stuff, and Seidler and Johnson, they are getting good points as well. So was it Johnson sits 41 points in front of Gerrard, but apparently he had a points penalty last time out, so that makes it rather interesting. I know Callum Hodgkin, I was talking to him before, so he's sitting in the top three, but he's a fair few points back there, 103 back. So, you know, maybe he needs Matty and Pete to have a little moment tonight. You might be praying for the damage gods to come to the fore.
Yeah, I think, we know time and time again, these cars and these sorts of tracks, they are either going to lend themselves on a bit of carnage or to some absolutely great on-track racing. Maybe we get both, have the perfect combination here tonight. But they also have the unknown about them. You know, you cannot guarantee that everyone is actually going to make it home on the lead lap. You know, you could have your person who's been winning a lot of races, they could just get caught out at the wrong time and cop themselves a penalty or, you know, having to tow back to pits or even just a little bit of damage. And that can just hurt their whole run. Now, one race here tonight, Cowy, an hour-long race. So if you go out early, you have got time to come back with safety cars, but you're not really going to have that second chance at points as what we normally do with the sprint or super sprint format. So it's going to be interesting to see how it plays out, but it's going to be up to these boys to get consistency about them and just to try and just get those fastest laps in. Nice and early here in qualifying, because the further up you start, the better your chances to stay out of trouble.
Well, if this race stays green, it's going to be about a 40-lap race. So I just did a quick calculation there. These guys could probably get about 20 to 21 laps out of the fuel tank. So it looks like it could be a one-stopper. But of course, you know, any safety cars throws that out, you know, out the window or throws it up, and we might see guys coming a bit earlier. Again, tyres are pretty optional when it comes to this car. Just the time in the pits is one thing for these tyres. Like, it adds about 10 seconds to your pit stop if you take tyres. But the other side of it is that you've got to come out and drive, you know, a couple of laps with those tyres as cold as ice. And that's when we see, you know, the the trouble at the start of a race. We always see it. These cars can be a handful, a real handful, until you get the tyres up to temp.
I'll tell you what, Cowie, currently, as we're 5 minutes into the session, someone who actually has got some good pace about them here tonight is Keegan Caldwell. He's managed to put his car P3 at this stage, bettering a lot of the other amateur times, although he's dropping down the order a little bit as Konitska goes top of the timing tower with a 131.6. But Keegan's got a little bit of pace about him here tonight, although he does still struggle a little bit with some racecraft, a couple of, you know, to hear it, you know, time and time again sometimes. But we'll have to see, you know, when is it going to be that he rises up the rankings, starts to get that consistency about him, and really starts to become a danger within the amateur class, and if you move it to the pro-ams and eventually into the pros, when do we think that could happen for him? Because he's got the ability to cut the lap, but he just has to be able to do it across a whole race.
Look, it's one of those things. I mean, and you know, we see it in the V8 pro-am and the the pro pro-am and the pro-am classes, where, you know, just about every week there'll be an AM or a Pro-AM that becomes a bit of a bolter, because it's a track that he knows well and has maybe got a setup that really works for him there. So, you know, from time to time you can see these guys able to compete at the front of the field, maybe, you know, punching well above their weight. That the issue happens that, I know myself, for me to drive fast and keep up with the pros, I'm damn near driving at 100% right on the limit to try and stay with them. Now, that works fine in a sprint format or a super sprint, but in these longer races, the hour races, where you've got to think about tyres and fuel and all that, it's really hard to stay on that limit for the whole time. And I suppose the guys that have actually got that little bit of extra pace, they're the ones that are able to just dial it back a little bit and look after the tyres, and that gives them the advantage at the end of the race. So I think, you know, maybe that's the boat that Keegan is in at the moment, where, you know, on a push, when he's driving well, he can match the pros and the pro-ams. But it's when, you know, the tyres start going away, when you've got to, you know, think about other things, that's when, it, you know, we can see the gaps and the reason that we have the different classes.
So I have just noticed as well, he has actually dropped back down to about P14 now. So it's just a bit of early pace about him. The pros and some of the primes starting to get their pace up about them now. But he's still leading the amateurs at this point here in qualifying. So he still has actually set a reasonably good lap. He's back in the lane. We're on board with Jay Dixon though. He has the fastest lap in the session now, 131.433. So Dixon setting some good pace here halfway through the session. We can never count him out, can we, for a quality finish. Balak, though, pips him for the top step, 131.274. So Balak, who, again, someone with a bit of pace about him, but has just struggled with consistency a little bit over the past couple of rounds. If he can get that consistency under his belt, he's going to be a proper contender throughout this championship.
Well, he's leading the way in the Formula B's on a Monday night, and he's the runaway leader of the competition at the moment. So, and has been, you know, here with the F3s for the past couple of seasons as well. You know, we've seen some of those, you know, incidents and where he's had good races and bad races. I mean, that's what happens. But the pack here is so tight. I mean, you said Keegan's back in 14th. He's only, 7 tenths off the lead at the moment. And just week after week, we see that this field is not separated by tenths. It's separated by hundredths.
I mean, there we can see the gaps off the top time. And then if we go to interval, it's all orange down to P25 in Kevin Wakefield. He's the only person who is out above half a second. In fact, he's out above a second here in that top 25 positions. Everyone else is within half a second of the car ahead of them. Some of them even within 1/10 of a second. So the times are tight, which we are used to, Cowie, in the F3s. Now, I can give you a reasoning why Balak leads that Formula V Championship. It's because he actually races in real life, and he races, I'm not sure if it's Formula V's or if it's Formula Fords, but he is used to racing some of those early stage open wheelers. So, you know, with a 6K I rating, you shouldn't be surprised he has a bit of pace about him. But again, it's just going to come down to the old consistency factor for him to start really becoming the proper challenger that he should be here in the Formula 3s.
Oh, well, it's the name of the game when it comes to championships. You know, you can get your name up on the podium and
talk to the commentators every now and again, but if you want to be on that top step at the end of the season, then you need to, you know, minimise those mistakes and those poor finishes that, you know, tend to drop you down the leaderboard from time to time.
So as we are now 10 minutes into the 15-minute qualifying session, this is how the standings currently look. Dixon in P1, then it goes to Balak, Byrne, Bradley, Gallo. That's the 5. DeBono, Roberts, Konitska, Pocock, Bowen, that's the 10. Gowans, Johnston, Ryan, Gerard, Caldwell make up the 15. Not long to go, Cowie, although being that it is a normal round here tonight, they will have over the 15 minutes to finish off their laps. But if it'll only be one lap after the 15 minutes if they, you know, start it before that 15-minute timer is up. So they'll at least get, you know, that extra chance if they, you know, want to have one final run. But they will have to get across the line prior to that 15 minutes ticking over.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised to have seen a couple of the guys, maybe the in the previous couple of minutes, burn that fuel down. Remember, this is a fixed setup series, so they all start with a full tank. So you can burn it down, do your first few flyer laps, then come in, pit, get some fresh tyres and maybe have another go. But by looking at the pit lane, I think it was only DeBono that maybe tried that. There's a couple other guys that are still in the pits now. But again, I mean, when it takes you a couple laps to get the tyres up to temp, you know, that really, a 15-minute quality, it's only going to give you, you know, maybe 4 or 5 hot laps at the max.
Board here with Daniel Byrne. Balak has taken back pole position off of Dixon. They are swapping that position back and forth, lap after lap. They are etching closer and closer to a 31-0, possibly even into the 30s if they can string a whole lap together. But Byrne is the next man in the tower, P3. You know he's got pace about him, Cowie. He won the F1 Championship last season. And, you know, new team for him this season, Carlin's Motorsport. Both him and Mr. David Gallo went there at the start of the season after the Kittens ran out of 9 lives at the end of 2023. And you know what, he's had a fairly consistent season so far, but we're not really quite seeing the domination of Daniel Byrne of old.
Look, I think that it's just, Daniel's, I know he's racing in on the Monday night in the V, and he's copped a couple of, copped a couple of penalties, but he's also been sort of mid-pack and that. So making sure he's up front here. But again, look, I think that the top 5 or 6 in this series are really close. I mean, a lot of these guys have been racing together now for, you know, 3 or 4 seasons at least. So they know each other's driving. And, you know, with the absence of Phil Vella and Michael Cutajar, you know, it's those other guys that are now sort of finding themselves right up the pointy end. And, you know, fighting for race wins.
Well, one thing that's interesting to me at the moment, Cowie, is we're used to seeing the likes of Andrew Johnston, even a Matty Girard, even Brad Hudson sometimes up in amongst the top 10 with the pros. Pros are dominating the lap times right now. Top 11 cars are all pros, and then Johnston sits P12 for the pro-ams. So we're actually seeing a more expected split of lap times in amongst the classes here. A couple of amateurs kind of getting ahead of some of the pro-ams, but it could be an interesting night, and being that we're not going to get that reverse grid, it might be a bit of work for whoever starts around that P10 position to make their way up through the field. So we could be on, though, for some absolutely spectacular battles with amongst the pack, especially when those packs kind of start to spread out, but in amongst their own little, you know, their own little 3 or 4 car battles. You know, we could have 3, 4, 5 different little battles happening all at once. We're not going to be able to cover it all, of course, but hopefully we can
try.
Oh, we're going to try. We will. But hopefully we can get some good battles out there here tonight, especially amongst those top sort of 4 or 5 drivers, because that could be absolutely insane to watch around this track. And of course the strategy is going to come into play as well. So so much to come for us here tonight out of the Formula 3s. Under a minute to go on the session, so it's getting down to the nitty and gritty now, Cowie. If they're going to want to have one more lap, which Johnston will, because he'll be able to cross the line prior to that 15 minutes ticking over. But if drivers want to get a final lap in, they really have to be out there and cutting laps as we speak, because otherwise they're just not going to get a chance to do it.
Well, I think one of the reasons we may be not seeing, you know, the pro-am, a pro-am driver, an am driver really up in amongst the pros, is this is likely one of those tracks that these guys don't come to that often driving these cars. So, You know, when you've got a new track or a track that's not as familiar to the drivers, that's when you're probably going to see the pros will be the ones that are able to get on top of it the quick, you know, quicker than maybe some of the other guys. But when you're racing at a track that they know well and race a lot at, that's when you do see the pro-ams and the ams really putting on good showings, because it's a track that they practice a lot or they've had fun at driving. I don't know if I've heard any of the drivers out there tonight in the chat saying that this is a fun track. I think they're all worried about that final chicane.
Unfortunately, Mitchie Noble's PC is cut off again, and it's a massive moment there for Belak. He was pushing hard to try and better the lap time, and he's just put it into the wall.
That's the danger, and you know, that was pretty much riding up on the curb there, hitting that curb hard. See how it unsettled the car. You have a look at this. The first curb unsettled the car, and then, you know, that's why I think that there's going to be two safety cars tonight, because that is not going to be the first victim that that final chicane will have tonight.
Yeah, I might need to reevaluate my my prediction there, maybe. No, yeah, yeah. I think I'm pretty happy with just one.
You wouldn't let me change it before, so, you know, no, it's
not me. All's fair in predictions and war. Dixon pulls it up. He was unable to get above and beyond Caleb Belak there by the end of the session. Did better his time though, 131.12. So it could be a Dixon versus Belak battle. But again, it may come down to the difference in consistency that could be the game changer for either driver. We know Dixon is Mr. Consistent and Belak has struggled with it in the past. So we'll have to wait and see who's really going to get that advantage throughout this race. An hour around Magny Cours, it's a long time, Cowie. And with safety cars, it's going to feel like an absolute eternity. And it's only going to take away opportunities for drivers to get the moves done, because they're going to be stuck, you know, behind the car ahead of them, behind a safety car. So it's going to be make or break here for some of these drivers as the qualifying session has come to an end. A couple of drivers will be coming around just to bring their cars into the pits, including Mr. Dixon, David Gallo, Keegan Caldwell, and Sam Katakouzinos, who has actually made it into the session. He'll not be able to finish his lap though, so he'll actually be starting at the back of the grid.
If he started it, it's ended.
Yeah, we're over 2 minutes past 15 minutes, so yep. There was no way he could have done it. So we will await though all the drivers to grid up here tonight, but prior to them doing that, we've got to run through the starting grid. So Caleb Belak will start out of P1 here tonight for Pioneer DJ Racing with a time of 1:31.101. He will start just ahead of Jay Dixon from Downforce Racing in P2, with Daniel Byrne lining up in behind alongside his teammate David Gallo for Carlin's Motorsport second row lockout there. Greg Bradley will start in P5 ahead of Will Ryan from Pace Syndicate out of P6. With Marcus Konitska, his teammate, starting out of P7 alongside Velocity Simlabs' Dylan DeBono in P8. Dougie Gowns then starting behind his teammate in P9 on return to the F3s, with Dave Roberts making up the top 10 here tonight. Scotty Pocock will then start out of P11 alongside Shane Bowen out of P12. They will start just ahead of P1 for the Pro-Ams, P13 overall, Andrew Johnston out of P13. He will start alongside the amateur P1, P14 overall, though, Keegan Caldwell. They'll start just ahead of Brett D'Alessandro out of P15 and Matty Gerrard out of P16. Callan Hodgson will then start alongside Callum Rossander out of P17 and 18, with Brad Hudson starting out of P19 here tonight. Mitchie Noble will make up the top 20 here for this grid. Chris Swadling will then start at a P21 ahead of Mark Turner in P22, with Dean Sinkovic out qualifying his brother, so he gets another notch on the scoreboard there. He'll start at a P23 ahead of Matt Tessiero out of P24 here tonight. P25 will then go to Mark Cochran. He'll start ahead of Greggy Johnston out of P26, with Steve Sinkovic out of P27 ahead of Kevin Wakefield in P28. With Sam Katakouzinos making up the back end of the field, Adam Simpson was unable to set a time. Our race controllers are out there, and we're going to get ready to go racing here tonight. Cowie could be on for an absolute belter from these F3 cars around this beautiful Magny Cours circuit.
Well, there's several places in this track where it's going to be hard to go too wide, and we know that early on these guys, especially the pros, they'll be jostling for those early positions. So it'll all come down to, is it going to stay clean for, you know, lap number one? Well, we're about to find out.
Oh, car 10's back in, so Mr. Noble is hopefully going to be able to get back in and start at a P20. He is back on track, so Hopefully the PC can hold out for the hour-long session. Great to hear Mitchie was able to get back out there. Keegan Caldwell said, man, I thought I would have got P2 or P3 here. Well, unfortunate that you weren't able to there, Keegan. But you did get P1 in class, so that's still pretty good, pretty competitive. The leader has now gotten onto the grid. We're still awaiting Daniel Byrne, Greg Bradley, Callan Hodgkinson, and Adam Simpson to get onto the grid. But I don't know if Adam is actually here and able to go racing or not, but he is in the session.
I think is his name highlighted? No, it's actually grey at the moment in SDK, so perhaps not making it onto the grid. I know he had a shocker last night in the V8s that cost him, but here we are, about to go green. This is round four of the Shannon's Formula 3 Nationals. They're lighting it up. Keep an eye out for smoke. There's smoke a little bit further back, but clean from the front runners.
Oh, there's already been contacted behind McCochran.
Oh.
He's been spun, but Dixon and Ballack off the start here, Cowie. Dixon had a fantastic start onto the inside of one, but these guys are going to go two wide down towards turn number four.
And I saw was that David Gallo quickly got in behind his teammate there, so those two are going to be working a strategy, trying to work together, but they're going two, three wide at the back there. I think that's Bradley looking to get a move done on Gallo there, but unable. That's... And who's that trying to go around the outside? I think it's Ryan trying to go around the outside of him there. But they file in. This is lap one. It's a 60-minute race. So, you know, with 1 minute 30 lap times, we're looking probably about 40 laps if it stays green. But this is the Formula F3s here in SRW. Nothing ever stays green.
We've had a couple of crashes in the background. We'll get the replays up at the end of this lap.
One of them too, by the looks of it.
Yeah, have you got race control on the earpiece there, Cowie, so we can listen out for the safety car call?
Always keep an eye and ear out for them. So far, there's nothing on the radio, so staying pretty clean at the moment.
It's off the back here.
We will keep an ear out.
We can see the gap is already built, just a bit of a gap here back to Ballack. I doubt it will stay that way. But Ballack's going to try and push hard here to get up onto the back of him. And we'll have to wait and see if this is actually going to work out for him or not throughout proceedings.
Wonder if Mitch Noble had an issue there because he's great out in the pits. So I'm not sure if he was the cause or, you know, his PC issues with what maybe created it at the start there. We're going to have a bit of a look here and see what happened.
This was Mark Cochran off the start. We saw the incident in the background.
Spin.
Big wheel spin. Oh, and he's just looped it on the actual on the
well
curb
to
there.
Actually, the last couple of guys there did well to avoid hitting him there. So that could have been rather interesting. Keegan Caldwell into the pit. So Keegan saying he was on the pace tonight. I'll run wide. That's what happened to Del Santo. Did well to get back on there safely.
No, this was Mitchy Noble. This is what happened to him. So the SRW team driver. Oh, it was Caldwell coming back on the track. Oh, no. Oh, and he's accidentally jumped it back to pits. Unfortunate for him.
Towed straight away. That may well be a penalty for him if he jumps back in, because you do need to ask race control for permission to tow around here. But it is Jay Dixon that has come to the front. That Ballack that's managed to get past Byrne and Gallo as well. So
he's managed to stay ahead of them, Cowie.
He was ahead of them. Sorry,
yeah.
You're right.
I mean, he's done well. You know, Byrne and Gallo are no slouches. You know, to stay ahead of them and stay in the... You know, he set the fast lap of the race, 32.078 there. Still within a second of Dixon. Could be on for a nice little battle here if he can get up onto the back of him and drag Byrne and Gallo with him up to Dixon.
Early movers in the field. Dixon up one. De Bono up one. Andrew Johnson up two. Callan Hodgkinson up four. Callum Rossinita. I think that's how we pronounce it. I did speak to Callum a couple of weeks ago about that. He's up three. Brad Hudson up two. Chris Swadling up three. Mark Turner up three. Sam Katakazinos up 10. So he's probably our biggest mover at the moment. Our big loser, Keegan Caldwell, Mitchy Noble, and Brett Del Santo all down, you know, seven or more spots. And I think No, Adam Simpson hasn't set a time, so I don't think he is out there tonight, buddy.
He is. He is out there.
He is?
Oh, no, he's not, sorry. But he's lit up on my screen like he is, so that's interesting. But no, he's not actually out on track, so he is not in this race, of course. But Dixon still leads the way. We're on lap three here in this hour-long session. Just getting up to 5 minutes in, Cowy. No safety car just yet. Couple of big moments that have happened, but nothing that's really caused a proper stir of the whole field.
Well, I think if Mitch had stayed out on track, it may well have been called, but he towed straight away. Of course, there still is plenty of time left in this race and plenty of danger here at this track. And you can see already that, you know, the driver's trying to use all of the exit there and run off. But those curbs, and we think there was a big update for this track before, so I think the 3D curbs will be in effect here as well. So that's another new element that iRacing have added.
Racing Troll just announced as well a drive-through penalty for car 399 for unsafe rejoin. So that was Keegan Caldwell for taking out Mitch Noble there. He's just committed to the drive-through. So Keegan's night goes from poor to worse pretty much there off the back of that one. Unfortunate for him. Hopefully, you know, he can learn off the back of this. Drive-through penalty for car 10 time without permission, that being Mitch Noble. So he also cops a penalty for that too. So again, not really a big shake-up so far.
Look at that washout from Byrne there. That car slid out and he had to sort of bit off an opposite lock there to catch it. But that is the danger when you're pushing hard early.
So we've got Thomas Freeman over the radio.
Yep, just announcing that penalty for Mitch Noble for towing without permission. I'm not sure if Mitch is back out on the track yet or not, but both him and Keegan. Oh, look at that wide run there in the background. I think that was that Ryan?
That was the Bono.
It was the Bono, the Velocity Simulator machine using a bit of the grass out there, but he's kept it going. Has got Will Ryan in front of him here, so pushing hard and good battles early on. You can see the effect of the toe there. He's closing right up on him. Is he going to make a dive? No, thinks better of it. Oh, no. I think then that he didn't expect Will to break quite as early as he did, and it looked like he was going to back out of it. All contact.
Oh, a little bit of a receipt given out by Ryan. I'll tell you what, Cowy, that kind of goes back to the old adage of if you're not 100% committed to a move, a crash is going to happen. Like, if you're going to go for it, you got to be committed. You cannot go, you know, half-assed. If you're going to go for it, don't chicken out at the last minute because it's going to end in tears, right? If you're going to go for the dive, go for it.
Well, one of the problems, well, I don't know if it's a problem for me, he wasn't a V8 driver, but one of the issues that you have here is these cars don't have brake lights. So, you know, I think sometimes when the car in front brakes a bit earlier than you think, then you've got to make it too wide or you're going into the back of it. And I think that might have been one of those situations. But the good thing is they're both still going. Maybe a couple of 1Xs, maybe even a 4X in there. But they're both still going. And you can see behind there, Konietzka really jumping the curb. And I know, talking to the drivers earlier tonight, they said, you know, if you really attack the curbs here, I mean, there are lines you could take where the curbs aren't going to unsettle the car. But the problem is that undercarriage cops a bit of damage. It may add 10 or 20 seconds to your pit time for some repairs.
Look at this, Balak now trying to get the moves done on Dixon, but Byrne wants to try and get past Balak here down towards turn number 4. Can he get it done? Ooh, that camera angle really makes it look like someone's getting their nose chopped off, but it's because they're looking right at the apex. But Balak remains P2, but you know, it's happened now, Cowy. He's dragged Byrne up with him, and we're in for an absolutely phenomenal battle here between the top three of this race. And Bradley wants in the action in behind as well.
Yeah, so he's got past Gallo there at some point through that exchange as well. We know that Greg Bradley had a great season last year with the Pro-Ams runaway victor, and now he's been thrown up with the big boys, and you know, he's mixing with them and right where he should be.
We saw him dance it through the roller coaster section right there. And you can just see how much air, you know, how much the car just loses downforce as it comes over the hump. Greg Johnson, though, has had an incident further back through the field. We'll quickly check it out, what's happened here. What has Jono done to himself? Has he just run it wide and looped it?
Yeah, he's run deep, a bit of grass there.
Oh, caught the curb.
Oh, he's got out of the way.
Probably should have just held his brakes there, to be fair, but at least no one collected him.
I don't know, because he was stopped on the racing line. So, you know, he's had a quick look and got out of the way. I mean, I suppose in the end we could say it was a good decision because he didn't make any contact. But that is sort of one of the things that's in the rule book. Hold your brakes. That way guys can try and, you know, make a move around you if they see you there as an obstacle. But if you're moving... Oh, I can create danger. Nice move there from Kanitsa on De Bono, getting it done, but De Bono's not willing to give it up just yet. But he's got that done. Nice move.
That was Ryan, actually.
It was Ryan that did it. Sorry, yeah. Apologies.
To be fair, they are teammates, and they do run the exact same car.
Same car, yeah. That's what threw me.
So,
finally get used to sort of what some of the cars look like, and then we've... A couple of big team changes from a few of the drivers, so we've got to get used to them all again, plus a few of the new faces out there. But, you know, it's, I suppose Formula One's like that too sometimes, where you all you can look at is the helmet.
Yeah. A different driver. And that's kind of why they introduced like the numbers on the top of the helmet, so they at least knew who they were looking at when they were on the roll bar cam, you know, on the T-cam, so...
I was looking at Marcus, and he does have a different helmet. He's got a purple or bluish sort of helmet compared to the orange one of Ryan. So, you know, that's probably our only distinguishing feature at the moment.
Oh, Mark Cochran's had a crash, and I reckon it's happened at the chicane, Cowie. No, it hasn't. It's happened at the roller coaster. He's just washed it out. And what's happened here? Oh, he's gone way too deep, I reckon. Yep, and just looped around.
Oh, just tried to get on the gas a little bit earlier, and, you know, we see that is sort of one of the pitfalls of these open wheel cars. When you've got downforce, you're really trusting it, but sometimes you can just trust it a little bit too much. The car goes and it can be too hard to catch.
So since we're talking about helmets, we can compare their helmets now so we know exactly who it is. So there's Dave Roberts, the teammate of Knitska and Ryan. He's running almost like it almost looks like the Liechtenstein sort of blue off their flag with the red and the white. Pretty good looking helmet actually, but it looks like someone's done it incorrect because it has like the actual visor off whatever helmet they've taken it off on the actual helmet design. And then Knitska runs this nice sort of like day glow green, blue and black sort of look, and then Mr. Ryan running this sort of Miami, you know, GTA Vice City sort of color scheme of like a papaya with white, blue and like a pink in there. But look at this, he wants to run under Bono down into, oh, there's contact between them. Oh, and that was maybe a little bit of an overzealous move there from Ryan. I won't lie. Trying to go too wide on the outside through there. It's pretty much one line. Hopefully he doesn't go for it again, because that could have ended in proper tears. If, you know, that was kind of the nicest way that was going to end realistically.
Well, I think we've got three teammates there running side by side now as Roberts has joined Ryan and Kanitska. So that's, you know, maybe those guys can try and work together a little bit here.
Well, I'll tell you what, they've also got De Bono's teammates in Dougie Gowans and, Scotty Perkos on his teammate, but at least he has his teammate Scotty, Doug Gowans there, the grandpa, on return to the series off an absolutely mega, you know, distance of driving for a holiday. He did, I think, about 3,000 odd Ks or something like that, he was telling me. And he's back out in the F3. So I get to see him back out on track. And he's supposed to be coming back tomorrow night and on Friday night as well. And I know you mentioned he was out there for the Formula Vs on Monday night. So good to have the grandpa back out there again and cutting some laps here in some quite difficult cars to drive, really. I mean, all four options. I mean, apart from the 86, which is not difficult, but not easy either.
He'd be a demon in those 86s. He was our series champion a couple of times when we were racing the TCRs. So he does, you know, sort of love those cars. I know he sort of took a break from them to jump into the... I think that's Bradley's had a slowdown there coming through the chicane.
I think he's actually spun it because he was...
Ooh.
he'd actually, we ended up on the left-hand side of circuit, so we could be able
to... Well, he was P4. P4 at one stage, so yeah, that's a big moment.
So no further action for an incident between car 11 and car 85 on lap 8, so that was Ryan into Bono.
He's done well to hold that, so the chicane almost claiming its second victim of the night. But still going, and he's right in the middle of this battle pack with Konitska, Roberts, and Ryan and DeBono up ahead. So, look, the guys are, they're not holding back. We're only about 14, 15 minutes into this race, and already we're seeing sort of guys trying to make moves and try to put that the pressure on the car in front. And it is one of those places where I think the tow is keeping the packs together, but there's these tight sections, tricky sections that you know, really you try to be close and maybe force the driver in front to make a little mistake, because it'd be quite costly around here if it happens.
Just quickly as well, Caleb Ballack has actually managed to get past Jay Dixon here for P1. This was how it happened. He's been trying to line this up for quite a while. He managed to keep that sort of outside line off of turn 4, but it gives him the inside line for 5. So they managed to get the outside line for this next corner. Dixon actually just pulled out of it. He just let him have it, actually. So I think maybe a bit of strategy there. He knew that Ballack was probably going to try and force the issue and just decided, I'll just back out of this because there might be an incident coming off the back of it. So a smart driving there from Dixon. Kevin Wakefield, though, has had an incident. Where is he? He's off the edge of the track. I reckon he's had one of those little half spins. Speaking of spins, though, Dean Singovich has also run it off track too. So, Steven Singovich, sorry. Is running off track. So everyone just going here, there, everywhere at the moment, Cowie. Let's check out the track temp. Not driver input spot. The weather. Just check out the track temp. 28 degrees. So it is getting a bit hot. And, you know, this circuit is known to kind of just degrade tyres over a shorter distance of time. So that might be something that the drivers have to think about when they come up to their pit stop period is, do we take tyres or do we not, and risk it for the biscuit?
I could only really see maybe a few of the drivers taking tyres if there's a safety car. If there's a safety car in the next 10 minutes or so, then that, you know, you might have the time to be able to deal with the cold tyres. Also the slower, you know, the pitting under a slower time as well out on track means you're not going to lose out as much. And that may well become a factor at the end. One thing we do know about these Formula 3s is once you get to sort of 45, 50 minutes on the same set of tyres, especially if you're driving hard like some of these guys are, battling hard, there can be, you know, not a lot of rubber left on them, and they can be quite slippery near the end. So we've seen in previous seasons that those last 5 minutes can be quite interesting with guys really struggling for grip.
So our top three have just kind of broken away a little bit here from further back in the field. There was an incident just before. It was Mitchie Noble. He's currently a lap down on the leaders, and I reckon he's possibly rotated. He's on the back of Mark Cochran at this stage. And what's he done? Has he tried to... So Cochran's let him pass, and he's just locked it up.
Yeah, gone in too deep, locked it up. Well, it's good to see that he's out there still trying to give it a go. It can be... make it a long night when it's a 60-minute race and it's lap one, lap two, where you end up getting a drive-through penalty and putting you a lap down, and you've still got, you know, 50 minutes of the race to race. Now, there are a lot of guys that would just, you know, call it a night and jump out of the car, but, Mitchie's still keeping himself in the hunt, and a safety car could get him back on that lead lap and back fighting again, so... it's not over yet, even though it may seem a bit doom and gloomy.
Well, I mean, you know, he's coming off the back of being quite a seasoned Assetto Corsa Competizione driver, which I'm actually quite... I find it interesting he's not actually racing in the Friday Night IMSA series in a GT car, seeing that he's actually come off of ACC. But, of course, he's trying to learn the supercar, trying to learn the F3 as well, so... He's throwing himself in at the deep end, but, you know, fair play to him. He still gives it a go, still gets there week in and week out, and just tries to get the seat time in to get used to driving these sorts of cars. So it's good to see.
Yeah, look, a very different braking style in ACC. I think even with traction control, comparing ACC to iRacing with the GT3s, the braking is a bit different. So, you know, it can be, it's one of the hallmarks of iRacing is that, you know, most people consider it's probably got the best braking model out of all of the simulators, all of the closest to realistic. But of course, remember, every simulator is not going to get everything, you know, exactly right, because, you know, just the nature of the beast, you know, you're getting a computer to tell you things, not the actual mechanical devices when you're sitting in the car for real.
Well, I mean, you know, speaking of new sims, of course, Le Mans Ultimate released today as well. It is based on the R-Factor 2 engine as well. I've never tried it, R-Factor. I don't know if you have, Cowy. But if anyone out there...
I've heard good things. Heard good things about R-Factor 2, like the actual physics model and all that.
Yeah.
But I suppose, look, in the end, part of the reason that we come to iRacing is just for this action racing. You know, you can pretty much get a race, you know, at any time. If you race the GT3s, well, there's, you know, even sort of all times of the day, there'll be fields and races you can join for officials. But, you know, when we look at the league racing and just the, you know, the I suppose the support from all the drivers, iRacing is frightfully expensive. I know plenty of us would have, you know, $1,000 or more in the content of the simulator. So, you know, you can understand the appeal of some of the other sims out there. It's certainly not as expensive. But coming from a set of course of myself to iRacing, it was a whole new level. So, you know, and I think if you come here and you drive it for a length of time, you'll be hooked.
So the reason we're on JDX at the moment, he set the fastest lap of the race last time by Cowie. The net exceptional lap, 131.39. The previous best was Caleb Ballack with a 131.43. So he is edging that gap a little bit, you know, bridging the gap just slightly. But he's just trying to stay, you know, at that, about that second mark and into within a second. Doesn't want to let Caleb run away, but just wants to remind him that he is there and he is setting some absolutely ballistic lap times, you know, qualifying worthy laps out of this downforce racing car.
Well, Ryan has got past David Gallo there. I was looking at the split times of David Gallo. It's about a second slower than these front runners, so I think he might have got caught out there with a good move from Will. But yeah, look, the top five cars, you know, all lapping within a couple of tenths of each other at the moment. So
I just clicked on the Dean Singer, which said he crashed. I reckon he may have had a little micro spin, because I want to see if he was in the wall, obviously, because we want to try and get the jump on safety cars if we can. So what's he done that's caught? Oh, just a bit of a drift. Yeah, that's what it is.
He's caught it well.
He has.
That lockup wouldn't help those tyres.
No, definitely not.
Really get flat spots in iRacing. I think they're actually one of the things that R-Factor does fairly well from what I've heard. It's flat spotting of tyres, but, you know, I couldn't imagine driving a direct drive wheel with all those forces and having a flat spot in an open wheeler. It would be, you know, maybe driving a massage machine for 20 laps.
Yeah, would not be a very fun time. We are coming up onto the quarterway mark here of this race, nearly at 25 minutes into the session. Lap 15, coming up towards lap 16. We're here with Will Ryan. He's right up on the back of Dylan DeBono. David Gallo not too far behind, as well as Greg Bradley as well. So nice little battle here for P4 in this race. And again, Kyo, we say it time and time again, these guys are in the prime position. Take over those podium spots if something happens to the top three. And those boys just hopping curves like they're absolute pole vaulters then. And that's really, really playing with fire, isn't it? Because these cars, you bounce it wrong, the underfloor of this thing is going to absolutely hurt. And you're going to lose, you know, straight line speed off the back of it pretty much.
But I think you'll also see that's somewhere where the differentials and the lap times are going to see is the guys that are lining that up and hitting it perfectly. They're the ones binding that extra few tenths through the cane there, and you know, the pros that are putting those 131s in. I think we look at, you know, probably half of the field have done a 131 at the moment as their best lap, but you know, when we start to go down to about 20th, that's when we're seeing guys that are now in the 33s, whereas the leaders are still lapping in the 31s and the 32s in that impact. So, you know, it'd be one of the places where, you know, again, like Gilles Villeneuve, I suppose, you know, he used the curbs. Well, that was close. That was a nice move there. De Bono carrying a lot of speed through there, but they were so close. Bradley Wright getting in the mix there. Gallo just falling down a little bit. So maybe he's playing the long game, looking after his tyres a bit more than these guys. It's also possible that he's picked up a little bit of damage. Because as we said before, it doesn't take much for you to just lose tenths in this car. You damage a balloon or something and suddenly it becomes a pig to drive.
This nice little battle pack is just starting to form up a little bit. Some of our regular players are still having some incidents, including Caldwell and Noble. I clicked on Caldwell before once again. I wanted to check if he was in the wall because he wasn't classified as moving, but he is actually still rolling. I think he may have just had a little bit of a spin. Same thing for Mitchie Noble as well. He's still driving along, I do believe. Well, he is actually dropping pace. So, I don't know. We'll suss some of them out just quickly here on the replay. So this was Keegan's incident. I think it's just a spin down at turn four. He's just running a bit deep. He rotates it on the exit. So,
yeah.
Unfortunate for him. And then this was Mitchie Noble's incident as well. Done up through the roller coaster. No, it's not even the roller coaster yet. This is the corner that's been catching a lot of them out, just carrying way too much speed into that corner. He did well not to, you know, back it into a tree around, not a tree, but a wall or anything like that. We have got a comment here from Sean Vandermeulen. Happened to me last night. Jumped start black flag, then speeding in pit lane, another black flag, another drive through, but didn't clear black flags, so then stop and go all in the first four laps.
I did hear you asking on the radio, how do I get rid of my black flag, Sean? So that would explain it, buddy. That's pretty unfortunate. I think also I just heard on the radio there, race control was talking about guys, you know, get off the racing line if you've got a slowdown. So I think there might have been a bit of a comment or one of the drivers getting a slowdown and then backing up the pack a little bit. So race control was keeping an eye on things like that and, you know, making sure the racing stays clean.
I tell you what, for Sean, who's pretty much a debutant in the supercar all over iRacing at the moment, he's throwing himself in at the deep end and copping up some. You know what, Sean? We'll call your race yesterday a character building race. That's what we like to call it sometimes. Cow, refer to, you know, Tyler Laney's had some tough races in the past. Those are character building. So Sean's having some character building races. He is actually signed up for vets for next season, so he'll be coming into the vets. I assume split three, I would say, just based on his current pace. That's just where I think he will likely end up through pre-qualifying. Nothing against you, Sean. Split three is great. One of my team members actually won the split three championship in season 17. So, you know, and it's a good little roadway for it. And I know that your teammate, Rista Goey, is out there and he's absolutely smashing it, Cowie.
He's up the front of the pointy end as well, doing really well as well. But, yeah, look, it's, I'm thinking about trying to do bets, but I'm on the sim too much already, you know, with all the racing I do here for SRW and then the commentary a couple of nights a week, and I've just got to try and, you know, give myself some time. Thursdays was always a hard night for me. It's freed up now, but I mean, again, I suppose we'd love to live in our sim rooms, but real life gets in the road as well.
That's it, mate. That's it. I mean, well, maybe instead of doing both the Sunday and the Tuesdays, maybe you do one of the days and then come and do the Thursday at Vets. It's kind of a bit of a change overall.
Yeah, well, look, one of the great advantages of being a pro-am in SRW is that, you know, Tuesday night you get to race the track for the first time and then you can race it against on Sunday and have that knowledge of, you know, the race strategy and that to use when you're racing against the pros. And at the moment it seems that I'm getting better performances on the Sunday than I am on the Tuesday. And that's also because if you're racing on the Sunday, on the other side of it, you've only got a day or two to practice the next track. If I then add vets to the schedule, then, you know, that adds another track that you're practicing. And I mean, these guys here, some of them are racing in four or five series. I don't know how they find the time to practice and get up to speed. And, one of the things about iRacing is generally if you focus on one car, you know, you're going to get yourself to the pointy end probably a bit quicker than if you spread yourself thin. But in saying that too, you know, we pay all this money for content, you might as well try and experience it all too. So, and I think, you know, we saw last week with Sonoma for the V8s, it was very much a track that, because it was a track not of a lot of people driving, so we got pits strategy starting to happen here. But, you know, when you're driving a track that people aren't quite as familiar with, you'll see that the gaps will tend to be closer. But when it's a track people are really familiar with, that's when you'll see those, you know, AM and Pro-AM guys end up near the front somewhere because it'll be a track that they're much more familiar with.
So I wonder, Cowie, because they've come in before the actual halfway point of this race, I wonder if they'll actually be a little bit of fuel saving that's needed here to get to the end.
I worked it out and I thought you could go 21 laps into the race with the fuel. So I wouldn't be surprised to see a couple of these guys. Oh, that's Noble with another moment there. He's lost a nose, so that may well have been contact with another car. Is that Tessuera in front of him?
Yep.
So, and yeah, he's just run straight into the back of him. Oh no. So Mitch not having a good night tonight. And again, you know, with no brake lights, we've seen that sort of thing happen around here. And
Not even brake lights, okay. He's just driven through him. Like, he hasn't actually anticipated him braking at all. Like, that's literally, he has driven like he's not there. You know? And
maybe for Matt, the one shining light will be that it's happened right at the pit window. So, yeah, the spin's going to cost him, but be able to get that car fixed and get back out there again with the one fast repair that these guys have available to them tonight. Now, it looks like pretty much the entire field has pitted. So, right on that button of the 29 to 31 minute range. So, I'd say if it stays green, these guys will be able to get home. And it is Bellak. He's come out of the pit strategy with a 2.5 second lead over Dixon. That gap was a little bit closer before the pit stop. So, an aggressive pit entry from Bellak has worked out by the looks of it.
Yeah, both of them had the same actual pit time, but I believe the actual lane travel is Dixon's was actually slightly faster. So I reckon Bellak's maybe pushed a little bit harder here on the actual outlap just to build the gap. What I think is happening here is Dixon is fuel saving, because I think he knows they actually cannot make it home without fuel saving.
Oh, contact there with the race leader and Tessuero. That was a bit scary and shaky there. Look, I don't know. I don't think fuel's going to be the issue. I think it's probably more tyres. Now, as I said before, you know, once you get beyond 40 minutes in these tyres, that last 20 minutes, they can start to be greasy. So if Bellak is really pushing hard, trying to make a lead here, it may well be that, you know, he chews up his tyres and Dixon is thinking about the last 10 minutes of the race. But at the moment, you know, he's got a nice healthy gap. And, you know, with these guys lapping within a tenth of each other for most of the laps happening, you know, 2.5 seconds, that's gold.
Well, what's really going to change the landscape here, Cowy, is if we do, in fact, get a safety car. Like, it's going to completely change the game plan for a lot of drivers. I think you'd be guaranteed that you'd make it home on fuel at that point if we do get a safety car. It's a little bit up in the air because they came in prior to the half an hour point. Now, remember, if they cross the line with 30 seconds to go, there's contact with Sinker!
Sinkovic has hit the rear. Oh, no, and that's going to drive him into the pits. He's got no rear wing. That is horror, and I don't know. Is Dean just locked it up?
Steven. Oh, yeah, he's like forgotten his brake marker, and he's actually just plowed into him.
Oh, no, that's heartbreaking for Caleb Bellak, who's, you know, was putting on a great showing here on a Wednesday night. We've said before he's had a few moments and hasn't had really the rub of the grain, and that's another instant there. But unfortunately, Stephen, that's going to be a drive-through for him. but our race leader, he's going to have to come into the pits because you can't drive a Formula 3 without a rear wing.
I think that you'd have to argue, Cowy, that's race done for Ballack.
Well, I think the other problem is going to be if he picked up any manner of damage from the curbs, even if it was only slight, unless he turned off his fast repair, he would have used it up. So the question is going to be, will he still have a fast repair to be able to use?
It's not even just that, though. He's going to have to fix the car. He's going to be back. What? To the... If he was smart here, he'd put a little bit of a splash of fuel in. Guarantee he'd get home. Right? Put
I
that
don't
little
think
splash
fuel's
of fuel
an
in.
Issue tonight, buddy. I don't think it's an issue tonight.
I think it is, because what I was saying before the incident happened was, if we cross the line at 59 minutes, 30 seconds, they're going to have to do an extra lap. Right? So they might have enough fuel to get to an hour, but they might end up actually having to do an hour and 2 minutes worth of driving. So that's the question at hand, is, you know, that's the point I'm trying to make here. Ballack's now back in P15. He's going to have to try and, you know, wrestle his way here through the rest of the field. The thing that I'm worried about now, Cowy, is him overdriving the car, trying to make up for what he's lost now. And that's where we could see some carnage come in.
Even though he has come out here, he's come out sort of in a bit of a battle pack. So, you know, as far as the enjoyment of the night, he'll get to try and make a few more moves on here. I mean, I've seen that happen a lot of time, and then you end up with no one and you're driving the final 20 minutes of the race with no one there to play with. So that is one plus, but yeah, that's a big cost when he was out in the lead. And now Dixon and Byrne, there's only a second between the two of them. DeBono only a further one and half a second back, I think, so, or gap 1.5. So this is going to be close up, and we know how Dylan can fight hard. Dixon locked up a little bit, went wide there, and who's that? Is that?
That was Greg
Johnson.
Johnson
out on the edge there, just trying to stay out of it. But DeBono right up on the back of Byrne now. So, you know, things have changed at the front, unfortunately for Caleb Ballack, but he is still running, and he did have that fast repair. So I was worried the way they were jumping the curbs, it would have been easy to pick up a little bit of damage. And, you know, you forget to turn off your fast repair because it's only one stopper, and you use it up, and then you have a moment and you've got to come back in. Oh, DeBono trying to go around the outside there. He's almost on the grass. I think Byrne saw him coming and just went, no, I'll give you some room. I don't want to lose my wing.
So we've got Bradley in the background here. Johnson just trying to let these guys go as best he can at this stage in time.
That's a good recovery from Bradley too, buddy, because he was down about 7th or 8th position. He was up in 4th earlier in the race, and he had that moment and was falling back. But now, you know, the pit stop strategy, well, maybe he's one of the guys that really practiced that pit entry, so it looks like he's made up quite a few spaces. Just having a look at his pit lane times.
It was a 27.8, so it was average.
Similar to the guys in front of him.
And even in behind, it was only Ryan who was actually quite a fair bit slower. Who's that off? That was Sinker. He's still out there without a wing. And he's just trying to get it. I mean, what's that rear wing button? Did he back it into the wall?
He's come in and used a fast repair to fix his car because he had no front wing, remember?
Yeah.
And then he's gone back out, and maybe he's done tyres and had a cold. Let's have a look at his pit time. 7 seconds. So no, there was no tyres there in that pit stop.
He hasn't. I don't think he's actually been back in.
He's lost the rear and had a moment.
I don't reckon he's actually possibly.
Well, he
been
lost
back
his
in.
Nose, didn't he? He? Going into the back of Bellac would have damaged the front of the car, not the rear.
So he'd gone off here. This was back out of the pits. So he fixed the car.
Yep. And just gone wide. Okay,
yeah,
no,
so he's
covered
backed
it well
into the wall
there.
Somewhere. He's backed it into the wall at some point. This was a bit further on.
Is it been the chicane?
Oh, it was down. Yeah, there it is there. Yep. It'll do it every time.
He's used his fast repair, so coming into the pits, that's going to be a bit of a wait in the pits for him, and he's got a drive-through penalty likely coming his way as well.
So that could just be... I don't necessarily believe in karma, Cowy, but that could just be maybe the karma that came his way there for... making said mistake before, but I mean, who knows?
Steven, he'll be gutted that he affected the outcome of the race. You know, Caleb, that'll be the, you know, the one thing that Steven would be worried about is, you know, taking out the leaders. And unfortunately, that's what's happened tonight, and he's probably going to get a slap on the wrist from race control as a result. Caleb Bellak just passed Sam Katakazinos as well there, so he's starting to make his way through the field, but he's 20 seconds off the lead now, so that's pretty costly, unfortunately, for Caleb.
It is, and he only took the fast repair in that pit stop, so he hasn't actually taken anything extra, like a bit of fuel or anything like that. So he's just coming to fix the car, come back out. So he'll just be, it'll be basically, he'll just be probably aiming to get back into the top 10, I would say, at this stage. Because without a safety car, he's not really going to be able to make up much more than that, I would say, in these next 20 minutes. But we'll keep an eye on him. We'll see how this turns out for him. Bradley and Ryan, these guys having a good little battle here for P4. Gallo's in the background of this little tussle that's happening, and then Robertson Konitska kind of just chirping up Bradley, trying to, you know, give Ryan the motivation, I would say, back there. You know, and just possibly trying to wheel him on a little bit here.
Oh, Mitch Noble's woes have gone even worse as he's dropped out due to a connection issue now as well.
That was his PC shutting off again. He put the message in about 5 minutes ago into the chat. So unfortunately there for Mitch. I don't know if he's back out there or not, but that's unfortunate for him. So hopefully he can get that finished. Bellak, though, is still having some blinking issues here as well, Kerry. I saw it earlier when he was leading. I've just seen him blink in and out again. So hopefully the night doesn't go worse for him and he drops out. Hopefully he can stay in there and just try and make up some spots.
Well, at the moment it is Dixon leads to Bono, leads Byrne, leads Bradley, leads Ryan, Gallo, Roberts, Konitska. Is that Konitska that spun in the back there?
It is.
I think it was. So that's going to change. Pocock and Gowan's going through on him now, so that's cost him a couple of spots. He was running with his teammates, and now the problem with that spin too is the next few corners, that car's going to feel horrible. And Matty Girard now closing in on the back of him, so another possible position on the cards for Matty Girard, who is currently leading our Pro-Am series. And is that Dean Sinkovic leading the AMs at the moment?
It is indeed Dean Sinkovic who is leading the AMs. So he's he's having a much better night than his brother, I would say.
You said that. He almost ran wide there. Almost a commentator's curse, but he's done well.
He has done well. Still rocking and rolling out there in the Shannon's machine for Team SRW. He's doing well. He's been a strong competitor here in the amateurs, and pretty much the championship's been between him, Cochran, who's just in behind, and then Caldwell is a bit further back down the grid. So,
Rosanita he's got a 3-point lead over Schmalenberg.
Well, that's going to end now because he's actually out of the race. He's in the pits. He's been in there for nearly 10 laps
tonight. Either I haven't seen Schmalenberg out there. So Cochran. You know, whereabouts is Cochran running at the moment? Is he in the fight?
Yeah, he's in P2 in class, P21 overall. So he's one position behind Dean Sinkovic. Oh, welcome in, Pricey. Great to have you here, buddy. I wanted to put the offer out to you as well. Meant to message up. Would you like to join me in the broadcast booth Friday night for IMSA? Let me know, because unfortunately my new co-host, Stephanie Piccoli, is actually preoccupied Friday night, so she won't be back until next week.
Yeah, unfortunately for you, not me, I'm gigging on Friday night. But Tessie O'Hara and Callum Rosanita are both in the pits at the moment, and they've been in there a while, so they've used up their fast repairs and are now waiting for the cars to get fixed. Sorry, so that will make a change on the leaderboard for the AM class. I know Matt is up. Was Matt up in the Pro-Ams this season?
Well, Tessie O'Hara is in the amateur class, so he's still an amateur.
Still an amateur.
And also, big news as well, we've had no regrading so far here in the F3's Cowy, so the admins believe they've gotten the gradings right. I'd have to make the argument they have. I mean, I know we were talking about Johnston possibly going up to pro class, but the last couple of weeks he has actually struggled at some of the tracks, so possibly his good performances were coming because he was used to those tracks that we were racing at. But yeah, it's one of those things.
Well, look, you know, I had a discussion with Race Control today in one of the private channels for the broadcast team, and I mean, it's a thankless job. It's really hard to grade people, especially when you've got such a wide breadth of, you know, experience in certain tracks. I mean, you know, you put all of us in a Vita around Bathurst and we're really close, you know. Then put us on a track like Magny Cours or Sonoma where there's not that much experience, then it'll come down to the guys that have had the chance to practice through the week, maybe got a handle on it. And that was the same. That was very much the issue for my team. We had a good result last week for Sonoma because we put in the practice. But, you know, again, as we said before, some of these guys are driving three or four series for SRW, not to mention driving, you know, F3s on another night as well. So that's different tracks. That's going to create the, you know, the reduce the chances where you can focus your practice on a particular track for that week.
Well, that's right. Unless you're running series which run the same calendar, I mean, you know, Vets and Scops would be a good example, being that they both follow the official for the weeks that they actually race. Or if you're running in the pro qualifying series in East Coast, then last couple of weeks East Coast have run the pro qualifying rounds. Prior to that, they'll run the Vets rounds. So, you know, a lot of leagues follow officials or they follow the same calendar as each other. So unless you're racing in those series, then you are pretty thinly spread out. And I think that's also why we see the likes of guys like Dixon and Vela and Cutajar, even De Bono and Byrne, do well in these F3s because they focus on them. We don't really see them spread their wings and race in other types of cars because this is where their focus is at for SRW, and that's why they actually do so well.
That's why I'm a V8 driver, buddy. You know, I've dabbled in a couple other cars, but, you know, again, SRW running the Pro-Am and the Pro-Am, you know, it just means we get to drive the same track. We can practice one track for two races. And, you know, I think, you know, on the Sunday, you're seeing a few of the AM guys, other Pro-AM guys really mixing it with the pros as a result of that. You get a race under your belt. You've worked out a strategy for it. Well, what works, what doesn't work. All big lock up there from Dixon as De Bono starting to close right in and put pressure on him. But, yeah, that does give you the advantage. Same thing, you know, when you're doing the officials on a Monday night, which is the big V8 series as far as the officials go, the biggest night where we get all the cars, and then you're racing Vets on a Thursday night, well then you're getting practice at that track again, you know. So I suppose you've got to pick your battles sometimes. Some guys can be great in all cars, others of us need to put in a lot of work to be on the pace. Or I think Dixon may be starting to struggle a little bit with those tyres. I did say it was around about now that we're going to see the tyres come into effect, and he a little wobble through the chicane. De Bono now getting a run down to T1, and he will get that job done now up into P2. Now the question is, can Dixon stay with him? You know, we thought before maybe Dixon was looking after his tyres. It may well be that, you know, this track he hasn't been able to put the time in. So under the toe here, he's getting a nice run and can fight back.
Did you see that wheel hop over the curb, though, by Dixon? I guess he went up a good three feet.
Yeah, he did well to control it because I think the car was unsettled there, and it's sort of one of those things where I reckon he would have had to have lifted to catch that, and that gave Byrne the chance, De Bono the chance to file past. But already that gap is a second, so I do think that Dixon is either struggling a little bit here at the track or maybe struggling on tyres compared to the guys in front of him. But De Bono now into the lead of this motor race. Where is Caleb Bellick at the moment? He's been slowly working the back. So he has picked up a couple of spots now. So working his way through the field, unfortunately still down 12 positions on his starting for this race. But yeah, look, it's one of those things, mate. We love our simulator racing, our fake racing, but you know, sometimes you just can't you know, devote the time that you need to. And when you're up against the guys that have been able to devote a bit of time to practice, well, they're going to show you up every week.
We just saw that Steve Zingovich pulled out the way of the leaders. I was going to ask before if we were possibly going to see another incident happen, but no, you did the smart thing. They just pulled up, let the leaders pass. He actually came into the pit lane just to kind of let the whole field pass. And I'm not sure if he's back out on track now. So, yeah, he's just driven down the lane just to let them all go by, and he's just trying to consolidate some points and a position at this stage in time. Cochran, though, has actually gotten past Steve's brother Dean for the lead of class now. So could be on for a nice little battle between these boys throughout this race. I know Mark does stream the races himself. So if you guys want to see his perspectives, although Stephanie's on in the chat tonight, maybe we can in future get a stream link off Mark and you can watch that at the same time as this one and see how he does in the amateurs and a bit further back down the order if we can't get on him all the time.
Big battle here between the Ams, so that's Dean Sinkovich is running a little wide there, Cochran, but he's managed to keep it in. You can see there Dean straight lining and jumping the curbs. I think that's the way, if you're going to hit them, you've got to make sure that the car's going straight. But these guys are fighting hard. The battle is just between the two of them. It's all lapped traffic around them. I think these guys may be down a lap already. No, it's Johnson and Wakefield and those boys are all a lap down. But there's plenty of clear track in front of these two. They can just focus on each other. So I think this is one of those battles that's going to keep going right to the end of this motor race.
Another battle we've got at the moment is the battle with the Pro-Am leader and a couple of these pros. A nice, enticing battle pack for us here. Gerard sits right in the middle of this. He's got Konitska Pocock in front of him. And then he's got Bowen Belak right behind him. So a nice little battle here. Gowans leads the way for this little battle. As we stand with 10 minutes to go in this race, it's DeBono, Dixon, Byrne, Bradley, Ryan. That's the 5. Roberts, Gallo, Gowans, Pocock, Konitska. That's the 10. And then Gerard, Bowen, Belak, Hodgkinson, Katakazinos is the 15. That's a big drop there for the grandpa. And that was Konitska spun round off the back of that.
I think was that Pocock that went really deep and fast through there. And I think that might have actually thrown Doug out a little bit. Because you look here, you see Pocock made a big dive and carried speed there. Look, he's gone way too deep. And I think that caught Doug by surprise. And there was a little bit of contact with him and Konitska there. So that is unfortunate for
both Scott and Sam.
Scott and both of them.
Oh, not Sam. Sorry, both Scott and
Dougie's looked like that car doesn't look too damaged, so he might have avoided it. But that was a battle pack of, 7-8 cars there, and now that's that one little moment has just created a bit of space, and Doug Gowans has come out on top. We'll just have to keep an eye out and see if Race Control's got anything to say about that moment. But unfortunately, for Konitska, he's coming into the pits to try and fix that car. So that's going to drop him down a few more spots. He was battling hard right up in that mid-pack there. So that's a bit disappointing for him. But it is racing sometimes. You know, you try your hardest to avoid things. And look, no one out there is deliberately trying to, you know, hit each other. It's just a mistake. But unfortunately, sometimes doesn't matter, you know, who you are, you can be on the end of someone else's mistake.
That's right, mate. And Andrew Johnson, we spoke about him, had a good start to the season, rolling out on his own a little bit here tonight. P16 at the moment, P4 in class. He's just trying to get this car home now with 8 minutes to go. Cowy, unfortunately, Matt, I don't think we're actually going to be getting to 2 safety cars tonight. We might not even get to 1.
You should have backed yourself, I think, buddy. You were thinking about saying 0.
I know. And
it's a couple of times now you haven't backed yourself.
I know.
If you hadn't said 0, I probably would have said 1.
Well, to be fair, I was unsure because, again, this track is an unknown. It's a 50-50 whether you're actually going to get safety cars. Like, it's one that you are either, you know, you're going to have to have a big moment happen. Have a big moment happen, and that then leads to a safety car where someone needs to tow back.
Well, something happened to Matty Girardi. Just seen drop down a couple of spots. So it was Hodgkinson got through and Pocock got through. So I don't know if something happened there.
I reckon he might have looped it up at the top of the roller coaster. So he's come up here. We've seen a couple of moments happen up here. He's got Belak in behind.
The gas a little bit hard.
Didn't hold brakes.
That could get called out as well. Good avoid driving there by Hodgkinson, I think it was. That could have been a heart and mouth moment for both of those gentlemen. But at the moment, DeBono's got that lead out to 3.1 seconds. I think Dixon is struggling on these tyres because now Byrne is closing in on him. And Bradley behind Byrne, you know, he's stayed within about a second and a half of this battle. It's been a great recovery by Greg Bradley because, you know, we saw earlier he dropped back a few spots after starting near the front, but he stayed right in the hunt. But it's Daniel Byrne here, the final podium position. But he can see Pete 2 in front of him, and knowing Daniel, this is going to be full attack mode now for the final 6 minutes of this motor race.
With 6 minutes to go, let's give a quick little shout out to all of the series sponsors. Shannon's Insurance, Warren and Brown Tools, Grimm Industries, Shunt Scenery, DSL Rail Services, NeuroPower and Motorsport Australia. Thank you for supporting the series and allowing us to go racing 6 nights a week. And if you guys don't want to miss any of the action throughout our racing week, please, please be sure to hit the subscribe button, hit the bell icon as well, so you are notified whenever we go live with racing across our 6 nights a week of racing, and also hit the like button as well. And get into the chat during the live streams, or get into the comment section after the live streams are done. Any engagement we can get will help grow the channel, grow the league, and help us bring you more absolutely fantastic racing like we've seen here tonight. If you guys are interested for more Shannon's Insurance Nationals action happening tomorrow night, the Toyota GR86s go on to track in their Motorsport Australia official series, as they do nearly every Thursday night. Really, they've only missed one Thursday because of some broadcasting issues. But the calendar, tomorrow night, they head out to Road America. Of course, you'll be in the comms box, I believe. Are you not Cowy for that one? Not 100% sure if you are or not.
I filled in last week because they're a bit short and it meant that Stephen could get out and race. So I don't know if they need me to cover again this week at the moment. I was actually going to jump on and spot Reese for his vets race, and then they asked me that no one could fill in, so I had to jump in. But then again, I had guys fill in for me last week for the F3s. I had a mate who, you know, just needed someone to talk to. As we've said before, you know, blokes can go through hard times and that as well. And if you've got a mate out there that, you know, is doing it tough, you know, all you need to do is be, you know, someone there, be a listening ear or a shoulder to cry on if needed. But we've got to be there for our mates. On our car, we run hashtag talk to me bro, which is one of those mental health initiates. And I'm sure that initiatives, I should say. And you know, I know plenty of the guys out here support various charities and run them on the cars as well, so it's great to see.
That's exactly right, mate. So I mean, regardless if you're in the comms box or not, it'll still be a big night of racing for those 86s around Road America. Friday night, of course, IMSA heads out to Long Beach, so that's going to be, if you guys want a popcorn show, watch Friday night, because IMSA and Long Beach equals amazing broadcast. It doesn't matter what it is, it's always fantastic around Long Beach. And then Sunday night, we're back for Silverstone with the Supercars Pro-Am Series, and Monday night, we head out to Alton Park for the Formula Vs, brought to you by Motorsport Australia.
But we must have missed what happened to Cochrane, because Sinkovic is now well ahead of Cochrane. They were battling together, and Cochrane just got out of the way to let the leaders through. So that gap is now about 4 or 5 seconds separating them.
So this was Bradley Hudson. We're just going to quickly catch up on these incidents. So this was lap 35. What's he done? Has he just looped it? He's looped it off the exit. Yeah. So, of course, he joined me in the comms box last week. He did a fairly good job, actually, in the comms box, Cowie. I must say Mr. Hudson did. And this was Cochrane's incident. He's got Dean in behind him. Dean pulls out.
Way too deep. Way too deep. So maybe concentrated on his mirrors there, and he missed his brake marker. But that's what's cost him, and given Dean the lead of the AM category.
And Dean kind of just letting it get washed. So the tyres are starting to hurt here, Cowie. And then Greggy Johnston's also had a moment as well. And I think Steve Sinkovic might be involved in this in the background, because it's also come up that he's had an incident. So Greggy's gone round here off the back of that. He's kept it going. Where's Sinko? How's he? Oh, and he's spun it as well. So the regular players in terms of corners that are claiming victims here tonight continue to claim victims. Just under 2 minutes to go of this race. Where is... there's De Bono there. We're coming up to start another lap. I'd say we're going to have one lap left, Cowie, I reckon. because they're going to have less than a lap length to go when they actually cross the line. Yep. So I think it might be white flag next time by.
Generally, the way it works is when you're inside the final 2 minutes and there's not enough time to do a lap. Yep, Barney is waving the white flag, so it will be one more lap to go. That's generally what it is. Once you're inside that final 2 minutes, it'll then come down to the lap time. If you're ahead of the lap time, then they'll call the white flag. So what I'll be looking at, this is lap number 39 that we're on now. So it's gone one lap shorter than we thought it would. So fuel not even coming into the equation for these guys tonight. I didn't think it would, buddy.
Yeah, I was questionable on it just because of the time when they actually brought it into the lane. I'd say they should be fine, like realistically. They're not really overdriving the cars. I mean, De Bono has done an exceptional job. So is Dixon, to be fair. Unfortunate, though, for Ballack, but he is back up into the top 10 now.
P9, yeah, having a great run, and he's
done well.
Just got past. Oh, he's right on the back of Gowans as well now. So, we see there, Dougie just struggling with a little bit of wiggle coming out of that section, and Ballack is going to have the speed to run around. Oh, Dougie's trying to hold the inside.
Great,
but we better get to the front.
Ballack's gone off.
So that'll be the end of that battle. But we're coming near to the end. De Bono has given up a couple of tenths to Dixon, but it's not going to be enough with only a few corners to go.
It looks like this is De Bono's to take home. Two corners left. Through the chicane safely and across the line. Dylan De Bono takes out victory out at Magny Cours. Dixon home in P2. Burn in P3, Bradley across the line P4. Was that Ballack calling that moment in Cowie? I saw him pop up on the radio thing just there.
Well, Big Race Control said they'll have a look at that incident after the race, but I'm not sure if it was that one or not. But it's one of those things when you're racing so close. I don't know if we saw any contact there, but I mean, a little jink can really throw you off. But that's Matty Gerard coming home P12 ahead of Hodgkinson, who had a pretty good fight back there at the end.
They were P1-2 for the Pro-Ams as well. Johnston P3 here tonight.
And at the moment, looks like Sinkovic, he's got quite a few seconds over Cochrane now. So it's about 20 seconds. So Matty.
In fact, Cochrane's actually finished the race because he was behind the leader. Sinker's just got to finish this. I don't even think he actually needs to finish this lap, and he's already gotten the win because he's already been and done lap 38.
He's still ahead of Dixon, and I'd say that, I'd say he got across the line maybe just before De Bono finished that race, so he's had to do the extra lap, so he's the last car out on track. But brings it home.
He does do that indeed. So it was a good run from the winner here tonight, Dylan De Bono. We'll run through our results, then we'll get some interviews underway, of course. We want the winners of the Pro-Am and the amateur class, and then the top three here tonight being De Bono, Dixon, and Byrne. But our race results will go for the overall classifications. This is how they're scored. But they're scored overall, but it goes towards their class rankings. So Dylan De Bono comes home P1 here tonight for Velocity Simlab. He will finish just ahead of Jay Dixon there in P2. Daniel Byrne will come home in P3 for Carlin's Motorsport, with Greg Bradley making it home there in P4. Will Ryan will then come home in P5 with Dave Roberts crossing the line in P6 here tonight. Then we'll have David Gallo, Doug Gowans, Caleb Ballack, and Shane Bowen making up the top 10. Then it's Scott Pocock just missing out on that top 10 finish. He gets home P11. So then Matty Gerard, P1 in the Pro-Am class, P12 overall. So he will get scored for P12 here tonight. Callan Hodgson will come home P2 in class, P13 overall. Brett Del Santo, he'll come home in P14 here tonight. Andrew Johnston then comes home P15 ahead of Sam Katakazinos in behind, with Chris Swadling coming in P17. Brad Hudson will then come home in P18 ahead of Marcus Konitska here tonight. We then get into P1 for the amateurs, making up the top 20. Dean Singovich for Team SRW. Mark Cochran will then come home P2 in class, P21 overall, with Keegan Caldwell making up the podium for the amateurs. Greg Johnson then comes home P23 ahead of Kevin Wakefield, Steve Zingovich, Matt Tesiero, Callum Rossander, Mitch Noble. Unfortunately, Rossander, Noble, Turner, all heap of laps down. They did not end up crossing the line at the end of this race. But it's De Bono who is the talk of the town right now. Cowy will show the pro results. So this is how they were ordered for the pros, but they are scored overall, of course. And then for the pro-ams here as well, our provisional race results here tonight. And then for the amateurs, Dean Singovich takes out victory, as we mentioned. So a good night of racing here, Cowy. No safety cars around Magny Cours. And again, it's as I mentioned at the start, it's a bit of a Silverstone type circuit. It's a 50-50 on if you're actually going to get safety cars. And again, needs to be one of those really big moments to be guaranteed a safety car, I think. And this track's like that.
Well, look, I think so. That incident at the start of the late race with Keegan, he's actually done pretty well to recover and bring it home in P3 in class as well there at the end. But I think quite a few of the amateurs fell foul of Magny Cours tonight. We saw, three or four of them not finishing. Definitely been a track that I think that the guys that are, you know, still trying to get their handle on these machines really struggled. Unfortunately for Caleb Bellack, it was not his fault, but a great recovery to bring it back home in P9 after having to pit for a fast repair just, two laps after pitting normally. So we know that it happens in racing. I did hear on the radio Stephen apologising to Caleb there, but unfortunately an apology doesn't have any points associated with it.
No, that's right, mate. We have got Dean Singovich in the green room. We'll drag him in just a second here for our first interview of the night. There he is in his car getting ready to go racing here. So we'll drag him in. Mr. Sinkovich, it is becoming an absolute whitewash with you and your brother out there in terms of who is better in an F3 car. Of course, he is now the talk of the town for pretty much changing the whole landscape of this race. But, I mean, you know, another good round for you here tonight in the amateurs. You're doing pretty well for yourself, mate, in your return season to the F3s. I mean, how's it been for you here in the first couple of rounds?
Oh, it's not easy. I can tell you what, me and Mark Cochran were having a bit of a battle there near the end, and I was a little bit faster, but I made a mistake and he got in front of me. And, so it was just battling, trying to get back in front, and he made a mistake, and I just, I should have taken it a little bit easier. I should have been probably 5 minutes ahead. Had a bad start today too, so I ended up on the grass first lap. So, yeah, a few mistakes there, but overall, season-wise, it's, like I say, I battle each week to, I aim for top 10. I got to 20. That's good enough for me. I'm happy to beat the next person in front of me, so that's always the target.
Is that the trickiest track you've driven in the F3 so far this season? Because it looked like it was a handful at times.
You know what? I wouldn't call it tricky. I just call it, you've got to be on it all the time. So many braking points and hard braking points as well, and fast corners. So it was like those chicanes, if you hit them wrong, you go off the track. And then some of those slow corners, if you're not braking hard enough, you go off track again. So it was difficult for both parts. But it was, you know, good battle early on, and a bit quiet at the middle of the race. But then another battle with Mark at the end. So it was good. Good fun.
Well, with no Schmalenberg out there tonight and Rossinita having his moment, Cochran is probably going to take the lead of the championship, but that's a good points haul for you tonight. It's going to be pretty close between you guys out there.
I reckon he's faster usually. Not on this track, though, for tonight, though. But anyway, it was a good battle.
And unfortunately, you maybe just got to remind Stephen that even though it was his 100th round tonight, it was, perhaps, he might have to do a little bit more than an apology for Caleb.
Yeah, you know what? He wanted to make a name for himself tonight, and he did, didn't he?
He did.
Oh, no, I was going to say, we've got Aragon coming up next week. Just quickly, how are you feeling going into the next round out there? Of course, it's been on the 8-6s this season. Now we get to tackle it in the F3s. How are you feeling going into that round?
Oh, I don't mind that track. I raced the 86s the other week, so it was good. A handful again. But it'll be interesting to see how we go with the F3. So it'll be fun. That's the main thing.
Well, Dean, congratulations on your class victory tonight, P20 overall, buddy. Let us know who you'd like to thank out there.
Obviously, first of all, we'll talk about you guys doing a great job. So well done. Pat on the back for both. Obviously, RC, the stewards, working hard always in there. They need to get a pat on the back. Grim, Warren Brown, Rare Spares, Shannon's, the whole lot. I'll probably miss one of them too, haven't I? Neutrons. Our sponsor there, Motorsport Australia. And thanks for everyone who raced tonight. So keep coming back, boys. And if you're interested, guys, get in the Discord or send us an email and get on board and race with SRW. So cheers, boys.
Awesome, buddy. Congratulations, buddy, and well done.
Thank you.
All right, Cowy. Do we want to bring in the winner of the Pro-Ams now? We have got a couple of we have got the amateur podium sitters in there, but normally we only bring in the winners of the AMs and the Pro-Ams, don't we? So
I think so. I suppose we bring them in and ask one question, but it's quite difficult to try and sort of get through everyone. So it was Matty Gerard that took out the AMs.
It was the Pro-Am winner, so we'll bring him in. Mr. Gerard, that was a fruitful evening for you there, coming in into P1 for the Pro-Ams here tonight. Been a good run for you this season, mate. And, P12 overall, I mean, you beat out a couple of those pro boys and you get the chocolates here in the Pro-Ams.
Oh, I love it, mate. Yeah, it was not a bad race. One of the boys, Doug, reminded us to look after our tyres at the start there, so we did that. And I just felt I just needed to pick off the Pro-Am guys. I didn't worry about the pro boys. Just let them do their thing. If they were going to take it out, they're all faster than me anyway. But let them do their things, and I'll just try and stay in front of the Pro-Am boys, which I managed to until my little hiccup, I think, about the third to last lap. It got me a bit sweaty. But managed to get Callum back and, take that P1. So I was over the moon.
Well, I was going to say, you were right in the middle of a battle pack there at the start of the race, so it was just about holding your line, looking after those tyres early on.
Yeah, 100%.
We know when you get into these long races, you know, the last 10 minutes can be pretty diabolical at times, but still not worth going for tyres in the pit stop.
Nah, it really isn't in these particular cars. It's not, they just take too long to really get some heat into them. They can be 2-3 laps even before you get some decent heat and you can actually do decent times. So, yeah, leave the tyres as they are and just fill up the tank.
Well, mate, I mean, we've seen you've been having a strong run this season. Aragon next week for round number 5. How are you feeling going into the next round? Compared to this track, what do you think, if you've done any practice at all, if you've done any laps around there at all, what do you think might be some of the things to focus on after learning what Magny Cours was like going into Aragon next time out?
Well, I'd like to be able to give you a good answer to that, but to be honest, I'm out the next 2 weeks because of work.
Well, that's fair enough then.
I'll be thinking about my work. Or at least I'll find some time to sit back and watch the stream. How's that? I'll chat to you boys then.
We were going to talk about you extending your lead in the Pro-Am class, but a couple of weeks away, one drop round. So have you banked enough points to count for that extra round that you're going to miss?
No, I don't think I have. It's going to come down to those last few rounds, I think. If when I come back, if I can lay a few good rounds down, hey, I might still be in it to get a podium somewhere there. What podium? I don't know, but I'll try my best when I am back.
Awesome, Matty. Well, look, thanks very much for coming into the booth tonight. A great race tonight. I think it was, P12 overall, as well as the class victory, buddy. So who would you like to thank out there, and congratulations.
All right, so Velocity Sim Labs is the team I race for. So thanks to all the boys once again there. We get together every week and do a practice and try and help each other out as best we can. So Original Digital Designs, JS Sim Shots, Here to Race YouTube channel, Speedhouse, and the boss man, Stephen, for helping us out with all our liveries and everything he does behind the scenes. Oh, I should actually, sorry, one more important thing is you boys as well, and SRW for everything you've done for the league. Thank you very much.
No worries, mate. Well, thanks for coming to have a chat to us. Congratulations once again on your class win here tonight. We'll see you back in a couple of weeks for round 7 when you make your return, but we'll also be expecting a doctor's note in the chat next time as to why you're not here, but you have to be watching the stream as well.
100%, boys. No, thank you very much, eh?
Thanks, mate. Appreciate it.
See ya.
Okay, Keegan and Mark have actually showed up. Why don't we bring them in and just get them to shout out their sponsors?
Yeah, bring both in.
Yeah.
All right.
Keegan and Mark, just to let you know, so we brought you in because your boys did actually show up, but we do only normally do the other class winners for the AMs and the Primes. But we wanted to bring you in because your boys did actually show up knocking on our door here in the broadcast booth. So we thought we would have a chat to you anyway. Keegan, we saw you had that early incident, mate, and lost out a bit of time there. But you managed to pull your way back. How was it battling your way back through the field to get at least into P3 in class here tonight?
Well, it was quite difficult. Like, I'm used to running in the field, and that's what I have a lot of my pace in. I like following all the cars behind, watching where they're braking, where they're powering on. But when I did crash through the first couple corners, I did doubt myself, and I was like, I was just trying to survive this race at the rear and try and get some points. But I'm quite excited how I went today. I hope I can bring it home in a P1 next week.
Well, mate, speaking of next week, we have got Aragon coming up. Have you done any laps around there in anticipation for the next race?
No, I don't even own the track yet. So I hope next week I have a lot of practice. I have a lot of practice to do around there.
Oh, mate, thanks for coming to have a chat to us. Let us know who's giving you the support out there, mate. Anyone else you want to give a shout out to as well?
I'd like to give one of my main sponsors, GeForce Gaming. They set me up with a new thin wheel and bass pedals, and SwaysFit, one of my little sponsors that asked to be on the car.
Awesome, buddy. Well, good recovery tonight after your moment there at the start of the race. We'll let you go so we can have a quick chat to Mark. We do have
pros
to talk to. Mark, so... Oh, what happened there, man? You were battling hard with Sinkovic for the victory, and it just sort of you got caught out a little bit, and then the pros decided to come through and split you up.
Yeah, I just made a silly mistake. I was looking in the mirror trying to see where Dean was, and then next thing you know, I'm at the corner, so I had to just slam the brakes on and try and minimize the mistake. And before too long, I was halfway down the escape road.
And then those leaders came through, and then fortunately, you know, that you can't really overtake them back. So I suppose you had to resign yourself to P2 in class, buddy. But how did you find the track out there tonight? It looked quite challenging at times.
I thought, yeah, it was quite challenging, and it was quite tiring because there was no real places for you to have a break apart from that big straight. But overall, I think the track was a good choice for the F3s. It produced some good racing from my perspective. I'm not too sure how the front was. It's a good track, I think.
Awesome. Well, let us know who's giving you all the support out there, buddy, and congratulations on your P2 in class tonight.
Thanks, Cowy. Big thanks to Packing in Advanced Simulations, Next Level Racing, Dubby, Fanatec, and Stump Grinding, Central Coast, and Tree Services. Thanks for your ongoing support.
Awesome, buddy. Well done there, Mark. We'll let you go so we can get the pros in and have a chat to them, Hamish. We're going to bring in Daniel Byrne, P3 tonight.
Yeah, we'll bring in Mr. Driver 808. Mr. Byrne. Daniel.
Hey, well, how was your night there, buddy? You were right in the thick of it for the whole time. Was it early on just a matter of holding onto those tyres, knowing that the last 10 minutes was where they were going to fall away?
Yeah, the entire race, I was a little bit scared of what the tyres were going to do near the end. And I've raced here a couple of times and had incidents both other times. So I wasn't pushing as hard as I probably could. And I was pretty happy to be able to be in the position of third and just kind of sit there and just nurse the tyres as much as I could. Not a bad result in the end.
Well, I mean, you had some good pace out there, mate. It's good to see you back up the pointy end, battling for these podiums, possibly even a win here or there, whenever you got the chance. Obviously, next week's our first, I believe it's our first F1 round, if I'm not mistaken. Obviously, you won the F1 series last year. It is our first F1 round. Sprint format. Do you reckon you'll be hoping to take that title back-to-back this year?
Yeah, that'd be pretty awesome. I haven't really looked far enough ahead. I'm not even sure where we're racing yet. But yeah, looking forward to all of those Formula One tracks that, like, or similar to Formula One tracks, really suit the F3. So that may be why I'm more comfortable there. It's wider tracks, and it makes for good racing. So yeah, looking forward to it.
Well, I mean, you know, we've spoken to pretty much everyone that's been in here tonight, as we are going to Aragon next week. So should offer up a good challenge. We've obviously had the 8-6s there already this season. How have you found the first couple of rounds this season? I mean, this is likely going to become the last season that we run this current model of F3 car, being that we'll probably be looking to move to the Super Formula Light when it comes in, as it is the most modern version of an F3 that we'll have. How have you been feeling this season in this car and with the possibility of a changeover for season two?
Well, I love this car, so I just hope that if they are doing the full move over, I really hope that other car is just as much fun to drive. So it's a little bittersweet, I think, because we've got some good memories in this car, so it'll be sad to see it go. But if they do it right, that car is going to be awesome. It's as new as you can get, isn't it? I think it's probably hasn't even really hit the racetrack properly in real life yet, so it's as new as you can get. And it'd be interesting to see if they're going to have the, I think they've got an overtake system.
So the SF23, which is the proper Super Formula, has got push to pass. I don't believe the Super Formula Light, which is what is coming in, which is the Dallara 3 something, I don't know the letters that are after it. It's basically Dallara's version of an F3 car. And I don't believe it has push to pass on it. I could be wrong though, but that'll be a new challenge in itself, but it's not going to be because obviously we spoke about in the chat last year about changing over to the Super Formula. It's not going to be as much of a pace discrepancy or a pace change from the F3 car to the SF23 would have been to go from the F3 car to go to the SF Lite. So I think it'll have its good challenges, but I mean, people that I've spoken to love the Super Formula, so I feel like this car is going to be just as popular as well.
Yeah, Super Formula is awesome. But the problem is with a car that fast is netcode kind of comes into it. So I feel like the F3 is probably at the right pace for netcode, and by the sounds of it, the new F3 is might be very, very slightly quicker than this F3 that we're racing currently. So it should still be pretty good, I think. So netcode shouldn't play too much of an issue, hopefully.
Well, Daniel, it's been another solid night of racing for you. I know that you've been copping a bit of the woes on Monday nights in the V, so it's good to talk to you out here, buddy. Let us know who's giving you guys all the support out there.
Thanks, Cowy. Carlin's Motorsport, Drive Radar 8 on YouTube and TikTok, Glam Radar, Australia's largest viral online beauty store, Little Rara, which are wines from Victoria's popular Pirin Vineyard, and Eagers Automotive, Australia's largest automotive retail group.
Awesome, buddy. Well, congratulations. Good, solid drive tonight. As you said, maybe a little bit within yourself, but that looks like what was probably required out there tonight. But congratulations, buddy, and I'm sure we'll be talking to you again next week, and especially with that F1 championship starting up. It'll be awesome to follow that as well, buddy. So well done.
Thank you. Speak then.
Awesome. All right. Let's bring in Jay Dixon, P2, tonight for the pros. Jay, Dylan was coming hard there at the end there, buddy. Did you just running out of tyre life? Was that the problem?
Yeah, he pressured me into a few mistakes. I hopped the chicane and had a slow down the lap he got past me, so that's why I sort of lifted super early at the hairpin, because I was trying to wash a black flag off, basically.
Those chicanes, like, you know, you guys were sort of taking them a bit harder than some of the other guys behind you. Was it just a matter of lining it up, straight lining it?
Pretty much, yeah. They're pretty brutal. Like the final chicane coming out of the front straight, you've just got to be prepared for it to, you know, kick you sideways, and then you've just got to catch it. I thought before the race started, like, that was going to be the difference between the pro and the AM guys tonight, was just how quick you could take that final chicane and not end up in the wall.
Well, mate, I mean, you've had a great run this season, Jay, obviously, and we've seen Phil in the chat the past couple weeks. He wasn't there tonight, but he's been telling us, talking up your ability to just get your strategy absolutely perfected. You got the car P2 tonight. You then got the lead. You and Caleb were then swapping back and forth. Caleb was then dropped out because of an incident. And then it's kind of just been a battle between you, Daniel and Dylan. But, you know, you still had a very strong run out there. How was it going around this track for 60 minutes? We've had a couple of sprint rounds these past couple of weeks. How was it coming back into a normal round structure of an hour-long race at a Grand Prix circuit like this?
I prefer the sprint rounds, to be honest. I can't concentrate for 60 minutes straight. My mind just starts losing it. Look, it was good. I'm glad I got a decent result out of it. That's the first time I've raced at that track as well. So to get a podium first time out is, I'm pretty stoked with that. Honestly, like, commiserations to Caleb too. He had that sewn up. I probably would have still finished second behind him. I lost a few seconds when he got hit as well. So, it was not that much fun watching the guy in front of you who's winning get taken out by a backmarker. So, commiserations there, buddy. Hopefully next week it's a bit better.
Well, it was a good points haul again for you tonight, Jay, keeping the Downforce Racing Machine up there on the leaderboard. Who do you want to thank for your team out there? And congratulations on your P2, buddy.
Thanks, guys. Thanks to the DFR friends and family. And thanks to you guys for putting this on every week. Thanks to all my fellow competitors for having a good, clean, fun race tonight. It was good fun.
Just quickly, Jay, am I seeing this correctly that you wear a Buzz Lightyear race suit?
Yes, and the pit crew has it too.
Exceptional. That's fantastic. Well, mate, thanks for coming to have a chat to us. Best of luck next week out at Aragon. And, if for some miracle by another driver, we don't speak to you next week, best of luck for the rest of the season.
Awesome. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, mate. Well, Cowy, we can bring in our winner now, Mr. Dylan DeBono, into the booth. Well, Dylan, two P1s tonight for Velocity Sim Labs, and you're the one that takes out the overall win. It was a little bit touch and go there. You got into some good battles tonight, but once you broke past Jay there, you managed to run away with it to the checkered.
Yeah, mate, that was the plan. It was a long race, 60 minutes. Just started off pretty slow, made sure no contact with anyone, saved the tyres a little bit. And then just went for it after the second pit stop.
We did see a couple of moments there sort of early in the first 20 minutes of the race where there was a couple little bits of wheel-to-wheel contact. But it seemed to be one of those tracks that was very easy to wash out wide on some of those corners, carry a little bit too much speed in.
Yeah, mate, for sure. You know, especially with the nature of their three car where there's so much understeer naturally. You're firing a little bit deep and... you're going off pretty big, so you just have to be mindful of all that, and especially when the fuel loads were coming off and the tyre wear was coming up.
So you were pushing hard there when you were trying to chase down Jay when Caleb was still in front. Did you see any of that incident up ahead that gave you a nice little gap? And was it before that point you were happy where you were and that incident brought Jay a bit closer to you and brought him in under the, under your radar, I suppose?
Yeah, mate. Like, honestly, I thought I didn't see what happened, so I'm not gonna say anything. But I thought I had the pace to be up there with them. You know, as the race ran, I thought I was going to be in a good position. I was pushing pretty hard to catch Jay. And once I got around Dan and was starting to catch Jay, I was like, this is going to be a good race. He just got a little bit unlucky with the slowdown, but that's racing.
Well, mate, thanks for coming to have a chat to us here tonight, Dylan. Let us know who's giving you support out there, mate, and anyone else you want to give a shout-out to as well.
Yeah, thanks to Velocity Sim Labs, all the help they do. You guys put it on the stream, and, thanks, everyone.
Very good, mate. Sorry, Cowie, you go ahead.
So I was just going to say the same thing, mate. Awesome stuff, Dylan. Again, you give us excitement each week, buddy. We see that, a little sentimentality. If the gap's there, you're going to go for it, buddy. And at the moment, there's been some good racing around you. So, the guys are appreciating those battles.
Yeah, mate, that's it. You know, and I've sort of, I don't know, the F3 hasn't been my main focus this season. I've just been trying to go with the 86. Just been doing heaps of practice in the 86 and trying to get better in that. And F3 is just for fun.
Awesome, buddy. Well, if you're racing this for fun and you take out the victory, you're certainly in the right zone. But thanks very much for joining us here, buddy, and congratulations on your victory tonight.
Thanks, guys.
All right. Cowy, it was good to chat to our winners and a couple of the podium sitters here tonight. It was a great night of racing, wasn't it, around Magny Cours?
Look, it's one of those things that was a fairly new track for, I think, most of the drivers out there. We saw, you know, where guys were pushing a bit harder. When you bring a 60-minute race in, you always bring tyres into the equation at the end of the night. But, yeah, look, I suppose the only thing, there was no safety car, so we both got it wrong again. But, you know, it was still some pretty exciting racing right there to the end of the race.
That's exactly right, mate. And I think... you know, Magny Cours may not have delivered on the carnage front necessarily, but it gave us a couple of spicy moments, but some really, really nice on-track battles, you know. And that's what we love about the F3s is their on-track battling and the fact that when they do go wheel-to-wheel, we're wincing and we're cringing because we're thinking, oh, they could touch you and there could be something bad happen. But to see them pull off some of those moves that they did here tonight was absolutely exceptional. And they delivered once again. And I'm really excited for next week out at Aragon. I think it's going to be an absolute ripper.
Well, I mean, I called the 86s there last week, and it's a hell of a track. That left-hand sweep around the back with the tyre barrier sticking out, I reckon it might have a few F3s names on it because it got so easily you carry too much speed around there and then realise there's a tyre barrier in front of you just off the racing track. So...
Oh, well, ladies and gentlemen.
It could be scary.
It could be. It could be real bad. But, ladies and gentlemen, that will bring an end to our broadcast here tonight for Sim Racing World TV. A little bit of admin just quickly. Big thank you goes out to all of our sponsors, Shannon's Insurance, Warren & Brown Tools, NeuroPower, DSL Rail Services, Shunt Scenery, Grimm Industries, and Motorsport Australia. Please, please be sure to hit the like button, hit the subscribe as well, and also the bell icon so you are notified anytime we go racing across all six nights of racing that we do every single week for the iRacing season. 9 rounds every single season. So you're going to get, you know, I think it's what? It's 9 times 6 there. Whatever the math is, I think it's 54 races you're going to be getting out of SRW TV. So why wouldn't you not be a part of it? Plus, it's free to hit that subscribe button as well. And, you know, with that, you'll be notified of when we go live with the Tuesday Night V8 Supercars series. And then brought to you by Warren & Brown Tools, the Wednesday night Shannon's Formula 3 Nationals, Thursday night Shannon's Assurance Toyota GR8 6 Nationals, which are also a Motorsport Australia official series. The Friday night Warren & Brown Tools IMSA Shadow Series, the Sunday night Warren & Brown Tools V8 Supercars Pro-Am, and then also finalizing our racing week, the Monday night Motorsport Australia Formula V Nationals, which is also a Motorsport Australia official series. For myself, Hamish Munro, and for Cowy, your average sim racer alongside me, this has been the Shannon's Insurance Formula 3 Nationals round number 4. Out at Circuit de Navarre Magny Cours. We thank you for your time. We thank you for allowing us into your homes here tonight or this morning or this afternoon, wherever it is you are in the world. But until next time, ladies and gentlemen, we will see you tomorrow night for the Shannon's Insurance Toyota GR8 6 Nationals. But until then, bye for now.
Tell you what, Bruce Tanner, James Dyson just absolutely drove away from us.